and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. St. Juliana Falconieri, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Today's Holy Mass is offered up for a vocation to the priesthood and the religious life. And today's saint, Juliana Falconieri, there's a little picture of her in our daily shrine, receiving her last Holy Communion in a very special way, a miraculous way, is a wonderful example of some of the parts, especially for girls, because she was a girl, but for everyone, really, as to how God's grace works. You see, she was from a very noble family in Florence at the very height of the Middle Ages, the Falconieri family, and her uncle was the last of the founders of the Order of the Servants of Mary, the Order of the Seven Sorrows of Our Blessed Mother, St. Alexis Falconieri. And she wanted to be a nun since she was very little, and as some future saints did, she tended to spend a lot of time in church praying, and her mother would reproach her, and she would say to her, "Now, Juliana, unless you learn how to cook and how to sew, you'll never get a husband for yourself." And she was thinking to herself, "Well, I want to be spouse to our Lord. I want to be a spouse of Christ, so that would be fine with me." The interesting thing, children, is how the Holy Ghost works, that far from being an impractical saint, if you could say so, that is to say, someone who just was praying all day long and couldn't do anything, she became one of the most practical saints of all, while at the same time being a high mystic. Well, when the time came for her to get married, when she was about 13 or so, well, then her parents wanted her to have marry a certain young man, and there was a little bit of a standoff. So they reached a compromise, as sometimes they did back then, that, well, she wouldn't have to get married right away, but she could live at home. Well, one thing led to another, and she was able to, through her uncle, become a member of the Third Order of the Servites. And back then, things were a little bit more loose, and the Third Order sometimes wore a regular religious habit, and they lived at home. The habit that they wore was gave them the name of their order, called the Short-Sleeved Sisters, the Mantellate in the Italian, because they had a shorter sleeve instead of a big, long kind of sleeve, because they did a lot of practical work. So pretty soon, in spite of herself, there she was. She was living at home and praying, but visiting the sick and the poor and doing a lot of practical things all day long. She was very practical, really, in her whole approach to life. She had a schedule, children. On Mondays, for example, she would fast and pray for the poor souls. She wouldn't eat anything at all on Wednesdays and Fridays, except Holy Communion, which she received. Saturdays, just bread and water in honor of the Blessed Mother, and so forth. And every time she prayed the Divine Office, she would say special prayers to think about what our Lord suffered at that time of the day. For example, at 9 o'clock, she would think about our Lord being condemned to death by Pilate and scourged and crowned with thorns. And thus she had a very organized spiritual life. Pretty soon other young ladies came to be with her, and they founded their own community, and they would come and go, and she was their superior. Pretty soon her mother joined her own convent, and they were very close friends, mother and daughter, and they loved each other dearly. When her mother died, she was very bereft and wondered whatever she could do. Well, she did an awful lot for the poor, and the lepers, there were a lot of lepers back then, she treated as her own children. Far from being impractical, she conquered herself so much that she could do something which for you or for me would be very difficult. A lot of people were going around with sores, with pus in them, and they didn't know too much about medicine or germs back then. So sometimes people would pierce the sore with a sword or a lance, but of course it wasn't sterilized, so they would get germs there, and it would hurt terribly. So what she would do is she would suck out the pus with her own mouth. Imagine how brave you'd have to be to do that. St. Catherine of Siena did the same thing, just as a way of helping the sick, and to showing that she loved them all as our Lord's most dear children. So there she was doing tremendous good and being very, very holy. And then some bishops and cardinals got the idea that their order, the Servite order, should be suppressed because it was a new order and there shouldn't be any more new orders in the church. And she, by her prayers, by her talking and influence, even though she was just a very simple third order nun, she was able to save the day. And the great work of the Blessed Mother continued the order of the Servite. Well, when the time came for her to die, she had had a terrible stomach disease, maybe because she fasted so much, and she couldn't eat anything at all. She very much wanted to make her last Holy Communion, but she couldn't, because she couldn't keep food down. So she asked that the priest could at least bring the Blessed Sacrament to her room so she could adore our Lord. And he said that he would. When he got there, she said, well, could I kiss the sacred host? And Father said, oh, no, that would never be permitted. You couldn't do that. Well, could you lay the host for a minute in the little golden locket called the pyx? Could you lay it over my heart? And Father said, well, I could do that. So he put the corporal down. That's the napkin that the priest spreads at the start of the Mass. And he put the little golden pyx with our Lord in it right over her heart. And she prayed very earnestly, and she closed her eyes. And when they opened up the little pyx, the host was gone. And so was she. She went straight to heaven. And when the sisters were preparing her body for burial, and they were washing it, they found the impression of the host, the I-H-S that's on every host, over her heart. Our Lord had come into her heart in a miraculous way for her last Holy Communion. Well, that's the story of our saint today, Juliana Falconieri. Pray to her, won't you, that many girls and many boys will answer our Lord's call to the priesthood or to the religious life. Our Lord has something for all of us to do. And if we start off being prayerful, we'll probably end up being very practical in doing something great for God. God bless you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.